We thought it would be interesting today to talk about some key questions to ask your heart surgeon as we're getting underway with this new project and very exciting. So the key questions before you undergo cardiac surgery.
Well, if you're faced with the prospects of needing heart surgery, I mean, there are a few things that could be more daunting or, you know, to scare the thought of, you know, someone needing to operate on your heart. We live in a time and place where even the most complex of heart surgeries are fairly routine. And they can be done with conventional techniques, minimally invasive techniques, robotic techniques. And so there are a lot of questions that a patient should ask. The first question would be, you know, tell me, doctor, what is my condition and what are my options today? And that's obviously a very important starting point. And the surgeon should be able to sit with you, give you the time you need to explain why you're here, what condition you have, and what are the surgical options? Because today it can be very confusing. Then you add to it the things that are on the internet can make it even more confusing.
So to those of you tuning in, please feel free to submit your questions for Dr. Singer in the comments section of this live broadcast. So we'll do our best to address as many as we can. And in the meantime, I do have a list of key questions here that we can discuss. So why don't we start with why is this procedure the best treatment option for me?
Right. When you're there in the office and you're talking to your surgeon, in addition to hearing what the options are, the surgeon should be able to articulate what are the best options for you. It's not always going to be clear cut. So let's take, for example, aortic valve surgery. A lot of you may have heard of transcatheter aortic valve replacement, which we perform with great experience both at Einstein Medical Center Montgomery and at Einstein Medical Center in Philadelphia. Aortic valve is the valve that sits between the pumping chamber and the heart. It's sort of the final doorway outside of the heart to the body. And that valve can get blocked over time. Then that puts increased pressure on the heart. The conventional approach is to perform open heart surgery, at which time we stop the heart, take out the diseased valve, and implant a new valve. That is still the gold standard, particularly in younger patients. However, over the past year since 2012, in the United States, we are able to do what is known as transcatheter aortic valve replacement. Now, initially, that was just for the most severely ill patients, or maybe patients who had previous open heart surgery. Now, there are studies, of which I was a principal investigator in one of the studies, that even low-risk patients can have that as an option. Now, when you look at the highest risk patients or the intermediate risk patients, it's pretty clear cut that if you can perform an aortic valve replacement using a less invasive technique such as TAVR, it's better. It's a little less clear for the low risk patients, let's say a 50-year-old who has a bicuspid valve. The transcatheter approach is an approach where there's no open heart surgery, there's no incision in the chest. We perform catheterization just like you might have cardiac catheterization. We perform it in the catheterization lab with the valve inside of your sternotic valve. At Einstein Medical Center, my partner, Dr. Alexandra Toluca, is truly a national expert on this technique, and she performs the technique with our cardiology colleagues. It's a hybrid procedure, meaning that we perform it. It's part surgery and part cardiac catheterization, so we perform it with our cardiology colleagues. So in Philadelphia, Dr. Christian Witzke, who is the interventional cardiologist and at Einstein Medical Center Montgomery, be Dr. Ed McGargy and Dr. Vincent Nguyen. And so it's a team approach, and it is certainly an excellent minimally invasive procedure. We have patients who are in their late 80s or even early 90s who are otherwise independent. They can have the procedure performed. They are awake for the procedure, and they go home the next day. I mean, that's how advanced that technique is. However, there are some patients who still require the conventional approach. For example, a patient that I'm going to be operating on tomorrow needs a mitral valve, a tricuspid valve, and an aortic aneurysm. Well, that can't yet be done with a less invasive approach. Now, I say not yet. Stay tuned, because the advances that we see today are truly, truly remarkable.
That's amazing. I mean, just almost day by day, I sort of, as a layperson, I do follow some of that information too. So it's just, yeah, it is. I think we say just don't worry about it, because good things are out there and they're going to help you almost no matter what. And I'm curious to know how many of these types of procedures you yourself have done.
You touched
on a bunch of different procedures, but
So, I mean, that's, your question, Sharon, is excellent. And I'll tell you what, I think patients need to ask their surgeon, how many of this particular procedure have you done? Now, I perform 7,500 heart and lung operations. I no longer do the lung operations, but my focus is only on heart surgery now. Of that, I performed about 3,500 valve operations, another 3,000 coronary artery bypass operations. But patient needs to be able to sit with the surgeon and say, the procedure that you're recommending for me, whether it's TAVR procedure, an open valve procedure, robotic mitral valve repair, whatever the procedure is, it's important to ask the surgeon, what is your experience? The surgeon shouldn't be taken back by that. The surgeon should be able to let you know. Many surgeons, like myself, have a website. Of course, hospitals have websites. So they should be able to tell you how many of them they perform. They should also be able to tell you what their outcomes are. Now, we're in Pennsylvania. We're one of the true pioneers in public reporting. Starting back in November of 1992, the Pennsylvania Healthcare Cost Containment Council was only the second in the nation behind New York to publish cardiac surgeons' data. So there's even more than that. You mentioned U.S. News and World Report. You have LeapFrog and a lot of other report cards, Vizient and so forth. But in Pennsylvania, we still have public reporting, and it's important that surgeons discuss what their outcomes are.
Okay. And another important question to think about, maybe not necessarily ask the surgeon directly, but people are probably thinking, do I need to get a second opinion?
Second opinion is really important. And you should mention to your surgeon that you would like to have a second opinion. Why do that? Well, a couple of things. First of all, if your surgeon doesn't want you to get a second opinion, you're probably in the wrong office. But the other thing is, the cardiac surgeons, particularly in this region and across the country, really, we know each other. And when a patient says to me that they would like a second opinion, of course, I support it. And depending on what their diagnosis is, I'll even direct them to who I would recommend going for a second opinion, and maybe steer them away from other people. There may be a surgeon who has a terrific name in the country, but that name may be, let's say, for valve surgery. And when the patient needs a second opinion for coronary bypass, that wouldn't be the surgeon to go to. So that's the type of thing that I do for my patients, and I welcome it. And I mean, look, if we're going to buy a car, we often will go to 5 or 6 dealerships before we make a decision, but we often just go with whatever our doctor tells us. Now, obviously, there is a certain cost involved to go for many opinions, but although honestly, it is covered by Medicare and most other insurances nowadays, and I do think it's important to get a second opinion. On that, you had mentioned about the surgeon's experience and outcomes. One of the things we should talk about is the importance of asking the surgeon, what should I expect after the surgery? So if I have the operation, what should I expect in terms of the length of stay, the hospitalization? What are the risks involved? And also, what is the care like, quite frankly, at your hospital? So, for example, at Einstein Medical Center Montgomery, we have 24-hour in-house intensive care physicians. These are board-certified intensive care physicians, and they have physician assistants and nurse practitioners who work with them. They are literally in the intensive care unit 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's a very high level of care, and those are the types of questions you might want to ask. What is the risk of bleeding? What is the risk of infection? Do I have a risk of stroke? What studies do I need before I have the surgery? Do I need examination of my carotid arteries? Do I need a CAT scan? These are just some of the questions that are important to ask, because the patient should have an expectation of, you know, what is it going to be like? And then perhaps the most important question, when I go home, what should I expect? Will I be able to walk stairs? Will I be able to drive a car? Will I be able to lift anything? And of course, when can I go back to work is a very important question.
And physical therapy and rehab, those are other things that you need to address.
Yeah, I mean, most patients will undergo cardiac rehabilitation, and we work with the patient and their family. Some patients, particularly patients who are a little older or live alone, can't go immediately home. And so we work with the area's rehabilitation centers and acute care facilities where patients can go for a few days, a few weeks if necessary, until they have the strength to live independently. We really stress that we want the patient to be completely independent when they eventually go home. And to that, we see the patients in our practice back at 7 days, and then we see them back at 1 month to make sure we have close follow-up. If they need further follow-up, then of course we do, but every single patient is seen by us within 7 days and then within 1 month.
Okay. And I think another question a lot of people want to ask is about pain after their procedures. How much should they expect and how can they manage it?
Yeah, well, everyone's different and every operation is different. I want to start out by dismissing one of the things that people always talk about with the conventional approach, which is the incision down the chest, the sternotomy. Those incisions are a lot kinder and gentler than when I was trained a bunch of years ago. The incision gets a little bit of a bad rap. People talk about cracking the chest or breaking ribs. Well, it's actually the conventional incision is one of the most well-tolerated incisions that we give patients. How's that possible? Well, when incision is made in the midline, there's no muscle that is cut, the pectoralis muscles on either side. There are no nerves in the midline. The nerves come from your spinal cord, the end of the midline. And yes, we do make a thin cut in the bone, which we put back together again with wires, which stay in there. And like any broken bone, once it's fixed, it doesn't hurt that badly. Patients are very surprised that even after the conventional sternotomy, that there is not a lot of pain associated with it. And there are no ribs broken. The ribs are to the side. So that's one of the things I wanted to tell patients, that if they do require a conventional operation like my patient tomorrow, the pain is surprisingly good. Most patients, when they go home, just need Tylenol. Now, having said that, there are other smaller incisions that we make. My partner, again, Dr. Tuluka, is an expert on doing conventional coronary artery bypass surgery, but through a small incision that's known as a mid-cap procedure. Or she also can perform aortic valve surgery through partial sternotomies and small incisions off to the side. Those incisions do not require going through the sternal bone. And in many instances, it allows for even a faster recovery and less pain than the sternotomy, which, as I said, is already well tolerated. And lastly, I just want to comment that on the TAVR procedure, there are no incisions. So the patients have puncture sites in the groin and they're up and about the next day and they go home. We truly try to minimize the amount of narcotics we give. We all know that there's a national epidemic of being addicted to narcotics. Good news is in heart surgery, compared to a lot of other procedures in the body, there's probably less pain than most other specialties.
That must be really, really great to hear for a lot of heart patients or prospective heart patients. And I could remind people, if you like, to ask Dr. Singer a question. You can just put it in the chat and we'll see what people would like to know.
I'd like to bring up, if I may, Sharon, sorry. The other thing about incisions that have changed over the years, a lot of people may remember the so-called zipper club, because when we did coronary bypass surgery, they would make an incision up and down the inseam of your leg for the saphenous vein. That is now done with telescopes. It's known as endoscopic saphenous vein harvest. The incision can be as little as an inch, and the vein is taken out with the telescope, and patients no longer have that large incision or pain up and down the leg. We often perform what is known as arterial revascularization, where we use an artery from the left arm. And that's known as a radial artery. And it used to be that we'd have to make a big incision in the arm, but that can be done with a telescope as well. So when I said earlier that the incisions are kinder and gentler than when I was trained, that is the truth, and it's part of the examples that I just gave.
Okay, that's great. So let's back it up a little bit. Somebody needs heart surgery. What do they need to do before that? How do they prepare for it?
Well, I'm also, yeah, you're right. That's important to know what they prepare for. We talked about getting the answers. And I want to mention something about that second opinion. We talked about it from the perspective of, well, if I'm seeing a patient and they request a second opinion, we see a lot of patients who need second opinions that have been seen elsewhere. One of the things we're known for at Einstein in Philadelphia and at Einstein Montgomery is we do complex cases like the one we're doing tomorrow. If you have been seen somewhere else and you were given a recommendation, feel free to call us. You can call our office, and usually within 24 hours, you'll get a response directly from one of the surgeons and an appointment that week or as soon as it's needed by you. So it's not just coming to us and then, oh, you know, you need a second opinion. We see patients with second opinions all the time. And I can tell you personally that if I know that there's a patient that's requesting a second opinion, I already know that they're concerned, they're scared, they want answers. And I make it a point to call them that night, even if I can't see them for a few days in the office, to at least get up some background information. And that goes a long way. Patients should do their research. They should use the internet with caution. Now, when it comes to surgery, we give instructions as to what they should do in terms of their activity, some of the more simple things like not eating after midnight. But some of the more complex issues are patients who are on blood thinners, and they may need blood thinners. When do you stop the blood thinners? If you're on blood thinners, you have to make sure your doctor knows you're on blood thinners and which ones they are. Another thing that people have to understand is that some of the nutrients out there people get at their vitamin stores can cause the blood to be thin. So if you are taking supplementals, whether it's fish oil or peppermint or whatever you feel is helpful to you or has been recommended to you, just because it's not a standard medication, you have to make sure that your surgeon knows about it, because some of these nutrients can cause the blood to be thin, and we like to stop them. For example, fish oils is something I take daily, but we tell patients to stop that a couple weeks early. Usually, if you're on aspirin, you continue that to surgery, but if you're on Coumadin or some of these other common anticoagulants like Eliquis, they have to be stopped at time. And some of the diabetic medications have to be adjusted or stopped in time as well. So that'll be provided to you. And antibiotics are given when you come to the hospital.
Wonderful. We have some questions coming in. One question is, how long does a triple bypass take?
Well, every patient's different. There's a saying that I have that the fastest operation is the one you do right the first time. But I would say that the time of surgery for a triple bypass is usually between 3 and 4 hours. Now, keep in mind that your loved one is going to be away from you longer than that, because we come in the morning, we sign the patient in, so-called ticket to the operating room at 7 a.m. They go into the operating room at 7:30, but the patient may not have the incision until about 8:30 because the anesthesiologist has to put the patient to sleep. There's special intravenous lines that have to be placed, there are monitoring lines that have to be positioned. And so the incision may not be made till 8:30. And then the surgeon concludes, let's say at 12 or 12:30, sometimes a little sooner, depends on the patient's anatomy, how difficult the operation may be. But you may, as the family member, not hear from the surgeon until 1. The surgeon may want to make sure that the patient is completely stable. Having said that, at Einstein, we have a really nice method of communicating. Our circulating nurses will take the patient's family's contact numbers, and they will update them actually during the operation. They'll let them know what time the incision was made, They'll let them know that we're progressing along nicely, and we will let the family know that we're finishing, that all is well, and that, you know, Dr. Singer or Dr. Samuels, Dr. Toluca will be out to speak with you at such and such a time. It, you know, a lot of it's expectations. And as a surgeon, you have to be careful. If you tell a family it only takes 3 hours to do bypass and it's 6 hours in between getting messages from the OR, then they're upset. But I think the method of communication we have is just superb.
Sounds like it. Here's an interesting question for you. Do people change color when they have a blockage? And then they say, for example, yellow, green, or gray in the face. Wow.
Well, so the blockage, so the coronary arteries supply blood to the heart. There are different types of blockages. You can have blockages that occur very slowly, and you may not even have any symptoms because other vessels take up the slack. We call that collateral vessels. Sometimes you can have a ruptured plaque, and a vessel can block off acutely, and that's what we refer to as a heart attack or acute myocardial infarction. In those instances, most patients will get cold and clammy. They'll have chest pain. It's often described as an elephant sitting on their chest. And yes, they may become very pale looking. In that instance, the best thing is to quickly take an aspirin, preferably a chewable aspirin if you have it around, or at least some aspirin, and you know, call 911 and get to the hospital right away. One thing I want to note on that is that diabetics sometimes will not have typical symptoms because of nerve damage. And also, I'd like to mention about women when it comes to heart disease. Sometimes their symptoms are not as clear cut. They might have tiredness or shortness of breath, or their pain may be in different locations. So if you have any doubt about yourself or someone that you're with, the best thing is to get them to the hospital right away.
So we're jumping around pre and post surgery and all of this, but after surgery, your follow-up sounds just marvelous, but what would the patient want to do to keep themselves healthy and heal quicker?
Yeah, so it's such a great question. Obviously, we need to all learn how to take care of ourselves better, including me, right? So common things. You should not smoke. That's a given. I'm still surprised today how many people out there continue to smoke cigarettes. So you should not smoke cigarettes. Alcohol should be in moderation. I think the most important thing people can do is walk every day or some form of exercise in some way every day, whether it's taking the stairs whenever you can, taking walks outside. If you can get yourself into some sort of aerobic conditioning, that's very important. You know, we can't always fight our genetics. My mother had heart surgery. My aunts had heart surgery. People will often say to me, well, if I eat well, if I exercise every day, can I prevent heart disease? And the answer is you can certainly help prevent it. But when it comes to genetics, what I tell patients is the most important reason to take care of yourself and to keep yourself in shape is that when you're eventually faced with your genetics, that you're going to be the patient who does well. And the patient that I have tomorrow, he looks fantastic for his age. He exercised so well. And he asked me, well, how did this happen? And in his case, it's largely genetics, but he's more likely to do well because he has taken care of himself. And certainly afterwards, you know, a lot of patients will say they have a new lease on life. So patients who have smoked cigarettes almost always will stop after they have heart surgery. Nobody really wants to go through it once. I can tell you, nobody wants to go through it a second time at all. And so we encourage people to walk. We get people up out of bed that night from their surgery, and they are walking their first day after surgery, even after conventional techniques. And so we really feel that exercise is the most important thing you can do.
Absolutely. Sometimes cardiac events are a surprise, this person writes. What preventive or diagnostic tests do you recommend for otherwise healthy adults?
I think we need to get back to going to our primary care physicians and getting a physical exam every year. I do. I go every year. And I can't stress that enough. Your primary care physician will make sure that your blood pressure is controlled. You know, high blood pressure is the silent killer. I've had really good low blood pressure most of my life. And now I found that my blood pressure has risen a bit. Maybe not a surprise after 7,500 heart and lung operations, but it was my family doctor who found that and placed me on appropriate medication. Your family doctor will check your cholesterol. And if there's any change on your EKG whatsoever or any question in your history, they may recommend a stress test. I've gotten a stress test just about every year. And thankfully, so far, it's been good. So it starts with preventive care, going to your family doctor. And your family doctor or primary care physician will also make sure you're on the right diet, that your weight is balanced. And I can't stress it enough.
Okay. Maybe squeeze in one more quick question. Or I could ask you, let me do it this way. Ask you if you have any final recommendations before we close out our half hour today.
We need to all think about what we eat, a balanced diet, exercise every day, drink plenty of water. And here's another one, which is getting adequate rest, trying to reduce the stress in your life. And again, your primary care physician can help tremendously with this. At Einstein, of course, I love my primary care physician, Dr. Christopher Drum, but throughout Einstein, we have tremendous resources with our primary care physicians. So I had to give a shout out to mine, but he's helped me tremendously. You don't have to go to a specialist right away. Now, your primary care physician will recommend a cardiologist when needed. And I think people should also understand that despite COVID still being out there, if you're not well, you still need to go to your doctor. Don't be afraid of coming to the hospital or seeing your doctor for fears that you might catch COVID. We take all the necessary precautions at Einstein, whether it's in our primary care offices, our surgery offices, our cardiologist offices. We have seen patients who have delayed coming to the hospital because of that concern. You should not be concerned. We also do recommend the vaccine. That's a whole other story. But my bigger concern on that is don't shy away from going to your doctor because you're concerned about catching COVID. The more important thing is to take care of your heart, take care of your health, and see your doctors.
There you go. Dr. Singer, it's been a pleasure talking to you today. And thank you for answering all these questions. I certainly have learned a lot. And I hope all of you tuning in today have learned a lot as well. And thank you for asking a couple of questions online as well. If people wanted to come to Einstein for a consultation, either that or a second opinion about their cardiac status, how should they reach out to you?
Well, they can call the office. My office is 484-622-2300. And you can also go on the our website, the Einstein website, for contact information.
And you get back as quickly as within the day, possibly?
We will be in touch with you that day, and we will set up your appointment as soon as possible. And as I said earlier, I'm more than happy to talk to any patient on the phone that evening to, you know, calm them down, calm their fears, and give them some background information. Now, before we do get off, there's something really important I have to say, which is go Phillies. We're a game and a half behind. Today is the last home game at Citizens Bank Park. And we can only hope that the Atlanta Braves continue to lose. We do play them this week, so we'll have to see. I'm a big Phillies fan.
It could do your heart good too if they win.
Yes, it does.
All right. We'd like to thank Dr. Ray Singer, Chief of Cardiac Surgery at Einstein Medical Center Montgomery. All of the behind-the-scenes folks helping us through our broadcast today. We couldn't have done it without you. And all of you for tuning in and joining us for Ask Your Heart Surgeon with Dr. Ray Singer.
Thank you.
For more information on our next edition of this ongoing series via Facebook and your other social media.